So thank you very much for the invitation. A very interesting meeting. I will keep talking about supergranulation. This work is was done in collaboration with a number of postdoc and students, Damien Fournier, Jan Langfellner, Björn Löptin in Göttingen, as well as Manfred Kücker from Potsdam. So I want to talk about observations mostly. Yeah. Using helioseismology, right? So I will first say something about solar differential rotation, especially in the near surface shear layer. I will try to explain in a few words what is local helioseismology and local correlation tracking for the people who have not really seen this before. I will talk then about measurements of Reynolds stresses in the sun. And I will also show some now a bit older results about the effect of rotation on the supergranulation flows, especially the kinetic helicity. Then I will remind everybody that supergranulation is still very mysterious, especially its evolution. Okay. So we are currently using some really excellent observations from the SDO satellite that was launched in 2010. Before then, we had 15 years of observation from SOHO, and as well as gong observations that keep going. What is very interesting here is some region of overlap between the two series so that we can check the results. Here you have a beautiful Dopplergram from the SDO HMI instrument. So it's a 4K by 4K Doppler image, so the line of sight component of velocity on the surface of the sun. It's definitely high resolution, full disk all the time. For seismologists, you can think of you know, every single pixel here as being one seismometer. Yeah? And the resolution is sufficient to resolve the granules, which have a size of about 1.5 megameters. By the way, at the top you have the size of the image from MDI. Okay. All right, so if we look at the oscillation power spectrum, on the x-axis you have the horizontal wave number, the y-axis the temporal frequency. If you if we focus on the modes of low degrees, okay, that means low degrees less than 150, these modes are trapped not only in the vertical direction, like any modes in the sun, but also in the horizontal direction. Okay, they are very long lifetimes, and we can measure individual frequencies for all these modes. And in particular, we can measure the splitting due to rotation. Okay, modes with different azimuthal orders have slightly different frequencies, from which we can infer the internal rotation. So this is a plot of the angular velocity in the sun in nanohertz. So it's omega divided by 2 pi as function of the scale radius. And this is from 97, OK? So in the radiative interior, you have nearly rigid body rotation. And in the convection zone, you have latitudinal differential rotation. Okay, so this is the curve at 0 degrees, 30, and 60. And so there's a, you know, very interesting layer of shear here that's called the tachocline. And if we look closer to the surface, there's also a very strong dependence of rotation with radius. Okay? Namely, at least for 0 and 30 degrees, the angular velocity goes up as we go inside the sun. If we look at 60 degrees, at least on this plot, it seems like the sign of the shear, the radial shear, has switched. Okay. So what we did is to reanalyze the observations. So first of all, analyze observations from the SDO spacecraft as opposed to the SOHO spacecraft, and also incorporate a whole lot of corrections that have been figured out by a number of people since 1997. And there's a long list. Some are very technical, okay? But what we find is that the logarithmic gradient of rotation, so dln of omega divided by dln of r, okay, which is unitless, is very close to minus one, okay? And unlike the previous measurements, it's really flat up to 60 degree latitude. You know, after that, we're not entirely sure about what, you know, whether we could trust the data, because the MDI and the HMI observations are not quite consistent. So I would say that there is really no evidence of a switch of sign in this radial gradient of rotation. We can ask whether we can understand this this radial gradient of rotation. And so some solutions have been proposed. I think the most easy to follow is I take this from a paper by Kichatinov, recent paper. Okay, so basically, if you look at a mean field theory, and you assume that you have a stress-free boundary condition at the surface, meaning that the Reynolds stresses between the V phi and the VR component is zero at the surface. Okay, so phi is longitude. Yeah. Then this condition actually implies that the latitudinal the logarithmic radial gradient of omega is a constant. Okay, and in order to see this, we need to find out a way to write these Reynolds stresses. Okay, so people have tried to write down the Reynolds stresses for a long time. Basically, there is a component that's due to that's a diffusive term, okay, due to turbulent viscosity here, proportional to the gradient of the angular velocity, as well as an additional term which accounts for the anisotropy of the convection, okay, the radial compared to horizontal anisotropy. And this term was introduced first by Kippenhahn in 63. Okay. So this quantity S here specifies the anisotropy parameters, and it tells us something about the ratio of the horizontal to vertical RMS velocities. Okay. In fact, it's defined here, and it must be greater than minus one. S equals minus one, which is essentially what we measure, means that the RMS of the radial velocities is essentially twice either of the horizontal velocities. Okay, so it's already a very interesting result if this theory is correct. I should say that some simulations by Kepilé have actually seemed to be saying that this relationship is likely to be correct. All right, so it is very clear that the Reynolds stresses are controlling the global dynamics in the Sun, and we would like to measure those. Okay. So I will mention again the expectation that there is a change in the dynamics between the near surface between the near surface of the Sun and the interior as the Rossby number goes from large to small. Okay, and you've heard a beautiful talk by Nick Featherstone, so I will not insist too much. There are various ways of defining the Rossby number or the Curie's number, but they all you know, they're all consistent with the idea that near the surface, the effect of rotation on the flows should be small. So how can we, I talked about global seismology before, now I want to mention the local helioseismology, which is a technique to measure velocities near the surface of the sun in three dimensions, but here I will only talk about the two-dimensional technique, which is based on using the surface gravity waves. And these surface gravity waves, which have a dispersion relation that's close to the dispersion relation of deep ocean waves, are essentially propagating horizontally very close to the surface. They probe the top 2 megameters. Okay? And so what we do is use a technique that's called time-distance helioseismology. We pick points on the surface of the sun, here called A and B, and we measure the travel times for F modes to propagate from A to B and B to A. And this is done by constructing a temporal cross-correlation between the signals measured at A and B. Okay. And then there are various ways to interpret the perturbations in the travel times that are caused by the flows. Okay. But it's easy to understand that a wave will go faster if it propagates along the flow than against the flow. A slightly different geometry here is if we take a point and then an annulus, and we measure the travel times between the central point and the annulus, going from the central point to the annulus, and then in the opposite direction. If we take a difference between these two travel times, we will essentially be sensitive to the horizontal divergence of the flow. And here you have a map that's constructed over 8 hours of solar supergranulation. So X and Y, and so I suspect here that the blue means that you have an outflow. The reddish, you have inflow, surface horizontal inflow. Yep. If you look at the power spectrum of this map, you see that there is a peak around a spherical harmonics degree of around 100 or 120. Yeah. And this is the characteristic scale of supergranulation, definitely. Now, so this corresponds to an average over this top two megameters where the F modes propagate. Now, if we want to, it's important to do some further analysis to really understand how much of this is due to signal or is due to noise. So we have a decent noise model, we think, which is in red here. That tells us that for all the small scales, basically we're totally dominated by noise. We shouldn't really worry about, there's really no information at the small scales. But for L smaller than, say, 300, okay, there's plenty of signal. And that signal is not only at the supergranulation scales, but it's also at the large scales here. It goes to L of 20 for this box. We may call this giant cells. Another technique to measure velocities at the surface of the sun is called local correlation tracking. We have intensity images of the surface of the sun, and they are separated by 45 seconds, right? So over this time period, using a correlation analysis over small patches, we can see by how much these granules move around. Yeah? And under the assumption that they are advected by larger scale flows, we can therefore measure this larger scale flow. If we compare the seismology from F modes and the local correlation tracking of granules, we see a very good agreement given by these two curves, the blue and the red here. So it's a power spectrum of the divergence signal. They both peak at supergranulation scales, and up to about L of 300, they are quite close to each other. After that, the seismology is just no good. It's dominated by noise here, okay? But the local correlation technique keeps probably giving us quite some signal here. So this is reassuring. We think that we have a good idea of what the horizontal components of the flows are at the surface of the sun, okay? Either from either technique. Oops. Yeah. All right. Somebody else did a similar analysis by tracking, this time, supergranules. You know, you can make maps of supergranules and then track those maps. That's another way of inferring horizontal flows. Of course, these flows would have to be larger scales than supergranulation. And that's the work by Dave Attaway and colleagues that revealed the presence of very large-scale convective cells. Okay? And in this paper, they were able to measure the horizontal Reynolds stresses, so V phi, V theta, as function of latitude. And they found a positive, small, okay, it's 10 meters squared per second squared, Reynolds stress positive in the north. Okay? And that's the sign you expect if you want to drive equatorial, you know, a stronger equatorial differential rotation. What I would like to note here is that these maps, actually, we had them all along. I see Brad here. In 2004, we had a paper where we showed some of these maps, and you know, they definitely had these scales in there. Okay. Even, you know, for quite some maps, basically, we had those. We didn't call them giant cells because we were a bit shy, I guess. What?
We weren't afraid.
Yeah, that's right. But these scales were all along in the analysis from helioseismology, okay? And you could see that in the power spectrum that I showed earlier. Okay. Another thing I would say here is that I have a student, Björn Lupton, who actually reproduced the results of Attaway, and you know, they're just very, very close, so there's no question that this is not noise, these are flows on the sun. All right, so we then use the surface measurement of the flows, V theta, V phi, to measure at supergranulation scales the Reynolds stress. And this is what we find here. So this is the red curve now. Okay? So it's a completely different answer that you get at supergranulation scales than Attaway got for giant cells. Okay, you got a different sign and a very different amplitude as well. Okay? On the right here, you have a comparison of the local correlation tracking and the supergranulation. They basically agree, okay,
for supergranulation scale.
So what is going on here? Are we just so wrong that you know, we so far from Attaway, or can we try to understand what's going on by looking at models of Reynolds stresses? So we contacted Manfred Kücker from Potsdam, and he generated a model for the horizontal Reynolds stress as a function of radius in the sun. Okay? So again, this Reynolds stress has two components, a diffusive term, turbulent diffusivity, diffusive term, and then a term that is proportional to, that has you know, powers of omega in them, the lambda effect that describes anisotropies due to the influence of rotation on convection. And sure enough, this model predicts that the Reynolds stress are negative in the north. Exactly, like almost exactly the same amplitude as well as what we measure. Okay, so that was very reassuring. So this switch of sign here occurs because this term here takes over near the surface this term. Okay. So near the surface, apparently everything is dominated by the turbulent diffusive term. And the lambda effect is really very small there. So the interpretation of what we're measuring is that, so at the surface it's very easy, okay? We measure the directly the surface Reynolds stress, but it's likely that Dave Attaway and colleagues were measuring an average of this Reynolds stress over some range. That's, you know, one possibility to try to reconcile all the observations. Of course, this is still quite indirect, but that's a proposal. I should like to mention here that the theory for the Reynolds stress, of course, depends a lot on this turbulent viscosity, okay, which was computed by Manfred Kücker in terms of a mixing length theory. Okay. Yeah. And well, you know, they're, it's not necessarily fully exact, but it gives numbers that are very close to what we measure. Now, we could also look at the Reynolds stress that I talked about earlier in the talk, the Reynolds stress between VR and VPhi that was used to explain the near-surface shear layer. VR can be estimated by saying that the variations of the densities take over the variations of the velocity near the surface, okay, using the continuity equation. You saw some equations from Mark Rass a bit earlier. So this radial velocity here is estimated from multiplying the density scale height by the horizontal divergence of the flow. And then we take the products of VR and VPhi. And we find that this Reynolds stress is actually very small for the local correlation tracking, as expected, okay, if you have to have a nearly stress-free boundary condition. So this is reassuring. Now, I don't have much time, so I didn't really expect to have much time for this. I would just say that even though the dynamics of supercondylation is not controlled by convection, by a rotation near the surface, there is an influence of rotation on supercondylation, okay, because the Rossby number isn't that far from one. And so one thing that can be done is to look at the correlation between the vertical vorticity and the horizontal divergence. And the prediction from infinity theory, again, is that this should be proportional to omega sine lambda over the time scale of supercondylation, which is 1 to 2 days. Okay. And so we've made measurement of this. It's this plot, the correlation of horizontal divergence and vertical vorticity. And we find the right sign and the right functional form as a function of latitude, as predicted by theory. Okay. The amplitude is actually a bit more than what is predicted. And this should be looked in detail to try to understand what's going on. Okay. So that is definitely the effect of the Coriolis force on convection. We're interested also in trying to see if we could resolve the vortices that are connected with the divergence signal. Okay. So what we did was to pick a number of supergranules, 10,000 in total, to shift them and average them to construct an average supergranule. And when doing that, we can actually locate in space the vortices that are associated with the outflows. Okay. And you see that, so this is vertical vorticity here as a function of latitude. So the north is here, south there, and you see that around the equator there's no preferred vorticity when you have an outflow. While when you are in the north, you have a negative circular velocity, a blue dot. Okay? And in south, it switches sign. So that's what you expect. OK, I just want to finish by saying that the evolution of supergranulation, if I can find the mouse, yes? The evolution of supergranulation is very interesting. So, I need to switch screen. Control F, yes. All right, so I explained how we construct an average supergranule. Now, what we can do is look at the evolution of this average supergranule in the past and in the future. Yeah? At t equals 0, we have maximum horizontal divergence in the center. So on the top left, you have the evolution of the divergence signal. Yeah? At t equals zero, we have a blue dot in the center here, meaning outflow. But as you saw in this movie, there is an oscillation here. So several days before, the blue dot becomes a red dot, meaning a convergence, and several days after, you also have a red dot, meaning a convergence. So you have a very well-defined oscillation here, with a period near six days, okay? Six, 7 days. And this was known for a while in the Fourier domain. Okay, in 2003 we had a paper on this. However, you know, I think it speaks a lot more in the time space domain. Yeah. So you see the evolution of that supergonulation scale. I call this traveling wave convection, and I would like somebody to explain this to me. Yeah. What is interesting on the right side here is to see the associated intensity at the surface of the sun. Okay? At t equals zero, we see that there is a little spike of intensity with an amplitude of about 10 to the minus 3 that corresponds to a temperature difference, temperature increase of about 1.5 K. Okay, very small, but we see that in the intensity data. Yeah. So these are, I think, very nice data. SDO data are definitely an improvement. Okay. So now I will finish. All right. So if you take this, the evolution of a supergranule, you can actually do a Fourier analysis and figure out that there is a dispersion relation that pops up. The frequency is of the order of 1.65 microhertz at a horizontal wave number of 100. Okay. And there is a particular relationship that goes like omega proportional to k to the half. This dispersion relation does not depend on latitude, and there is excess power in the prograde direction. Unfortunately, as I said, there is no theory for that, and I think even linear stability analysis is completely missing, so I would really like some people to help us figure this out. I will conclude by saying that we are able to measure Reynolds stresses at the surface of the sun, as well as the influence of rotation and convection, that there is a general consistency with mean field theory that was mostly developed by Rüdiger and colleagues. And this theory is at the origin of trying to understand the global dynamics of the sun. Helioseismology has the potential to characterize convective velocities deeper in the convection zone, of course, using P-modes. We haven't done that yet, but this is work to do for the future. In doing so, of course, we will have to resolve the question of the convective amplitudes that you've heard already three, four times today. And I really want to say again that supergranulation supports oscillations. Yeah? And this is not a little detail. It's not something. It's really in the data. It's so visible. Okay, you can't not see it. It doesn't matter what rate you track the data, whatever. It's there. And it's not understood, and I would really encourage people to try to look at the theories. Yeah? It may also be interesting for understanding the mean flows in the near surface shell layers. Yeah. Thank you very much. Yep, Mark?
Yeah.
The last point, I just want to be clear on what the oscillation showed up in the divergence, but not in the temperature perturbation.
I have not done that, so I cannot.
I mean, you showed the time series of the temperature perturbation.
I mean, I have not studied this in detail. We can look at the movie, of course, and you will see that it doesn't really show up. Oh, sorry, this is the other screen. So if you look here, right? I mean, it's a, first of all, the intensity signal is a teeny signal. Huh?
So, yeah.
But there's no obvious. There's a hint of it, maybe, but the problem here is that you have a combination of, you know, the network, the influence of the network field and the rest. Right? So when I say there's a peak, it's only because at around t equals zero, you know, you have a nice flat background around the center of the supergranular, and you see a little peak around on top of that. So, but of course, it's more complicated. This is, we're not seeing temperature, we see, yeah, as you know.
Okay, yeah, go ahead. And maybe you want to comment.
Yeah, just kind of a related comment. I mean, how is this different from if you just sort of picked a point on the sun and looked at how the divergence at that point, you know, think of like a granule or something, right? You have upflows forming, and then if you look at a later time, you have downflows forming, and there's a characteristic correlation time scale.
Exactly. So if you do this for granules, you do not see these oscillations. You have typically, you know, Lorentzian profile or something like that, that you can associate with, you know, a time scale. But there's no evidence of oscillations. And I looked in the simulations as well. I don't see it.
Last question.
If you, one more quick question. So if you take the Rossby number to be defined as the ratio of the vorticity of the supergranulation to the background rotation, are you getting Rossby numbers like very small, 0.01?
So I don't measure the Rossby number, obviously, right? But if I use the definition, yeah. But then I would have to have a better understanding of the turbulent viscosities, I think, you know, to make the connection. You know? Well, I don't know. But anyway, the Rossby numbers we have are around 0.5 or close to 1 for supergranulation.
All right, I think we should move on.
All right, so again, I filling in a cancellation here, but I hope I'm not overextending my stay, and then maybe I can keep my volume of my voice to a normal level when I'm answering questions. We'll see how that all works out. I thought it would be fun to show you some recent work that we've been doing on what I think is maybe the simplest turbulence question, and that's scalar transport, and in particular scalar transport in a very particular model flow, which is purely vertical. Okay, so the simplest problem I'm talking about is if we have a flow and we can characterize that flow with some statistics, then can we formulate a transport model based of scalar vector quantities based simply on the flow statistics that we can hope to measure. And what I'm going to do here is try to use the properties of the flow in physical space, and I'll motivate this a little more to do that modeling rather than doing that modeling in spectral space. Okay, so here's the problem exactly. If we had a scalar quantity with some initial concentration on the right-hand side of the equation here, then if this was a strictly deterministic flow, then that concentration would just be that source term hit against the Green's function integrated over time and space. If we want the expectation of a concentration in a turbulent flow, then this is like the probabilistic Green's function. It says, what's the probability density that if I start at point x prime t prime, I'll end up at point x and t, and I hit that against my source, integrate over all x prime and t prime, and I get the expectation value of the concentration. And you can get the variance the same way. You can say, what's the probability that if I start at two different locations in space and time, I end up at the same place x and t in two different realizations,
And so this is really the time reverse generalized pair dispersion. Most people think of pair dispersion as starting from a single point in space and time and extending outward. And all you're really asking is, how about moving backwards? And you don't have to hit the same place. You have to hit the same place at the same point in time, but you could start at any arbitrary space and time. So this is a generalization. And so the idea here is, let's just go after these quantities directly. Okay? Let's just try to see if we can model this this probability density. And to do that, we're going to try to use Lagrangian tracers because they trace the flow directly. And in the last, in this millennium, there's been a lot of work done with Lagrangian measurements in flows. And what people have found is that motion around the vortical filaments in the flow dominate the flow statistics. This is an acceleration PDF, and these accelerations can get very large, and these PDFs are highly non-Gaussian. And so originally, we want to understand that, and so we say, okay, we have a vortex filament in three dimensions. Let's make a vortex line, okay, and do the 2D problem where we have a bunch of vortex filaments going perpendicular to the plane and see if we can draw some conclusions about transport. If these black dots, we'll put in here some tracers, and we'll see if we can make some conclusions about this problem. Now, this thing that we're doing here is not quite two-dimensional. So let me just explain to you, and we've done this, and we've made very good contact with these non-Gaussian statistics of acceleration. We have very similar behaviors, and those statistics are dominated by what came to be known in Lagrangian literature as trapping events, where you get stuck around a vortex, you get these very high acceleration, and single point and pair dispersion statistics we've done in two different papers seem to be well captured by this 2D model. But this 2D model is not quite 2D because we have these point vortices on the domain, and what we're doing is continuously creating them, and when they get within a certain distance of each other, we merge them. And if two like signs merge, you basically create a vortex of stronger intensity. So if you create and merge, and they're the same sign, you amplify by stretching. And so there's some 2.5D, 3D nature to this problem. Okay? So what I'd like to talk about today is just getting this probability density function. Sorry, the movies didn't play. I'm going to consider primarily this simulation here. I've got a bunch of point vortices on the domain. It's an n-body problem. They all interact with each other, advect each other around. We're twice periodic, and so we go in and out of the boundaries. We got Lagrangian tracers in the middle. If we look at the statistics, we reach some steady state of number density. We have, in this case, where if we merge and we conserve angular momentum, we have an inverse cascade. If we conserve and merge kinetic energy, we can get rid of that inverse cascade. And these two simulations just differ in the distribution of vortex amplitudes that we choose. But we're just, all of these show the same type of transport PDFs, and so we're just going to focus mainly on one. Okay, so again, this is what we're after. We want to measure this. We can't measure this directly. If we measure this directly, we would need the solution for all space and all time. And so we're going to assume isotropy. So we're going to take P of R, and T is divided by 2 pi R. This is actually probability in this here, but that's the object we want. The probability density that we go a certain distance R, knowing only the statistics of the flow. So first of all, and then the goal ultimately is take the statistics of the flow, get P of R, divided by the probability by 2 pi R, come back to the probability density, plug it in here, and get the expectation value of the scalar concentration. That's the goal. Then we can tell you whether the radioactivity from Fukushima hits California or not, and on what time scale. Okay? All right, so that's the motivation. What do these things look like? Well, if we just It's a two-dimensional probability distribution as a function of time. It looks like this. The red curves are a Maxwellian, actually a Rayleigh function in two dimensions, would be a random walk. Okay? And so all we've done is taken these trajectories out of the simulation and measured r as a function of delta t and plotted here the distribution of r as a function of delta t. Okay? So it's the probability distribution of the Eulerian distance traveled along any Lagrangian trajectories, and it approximates a random walk where the variance is a function of time. So if I take this fit and I look at the variance, and I'm going to talk, the main point of the discussion is the difference between a random walk. But first, let's just look at the variance as a function of time. Then you have, as in a random walk, you have the variance growing ballistically for very short times, and then diffusively for very long times for all of these cases. Okay? And so here's the Lagrangian autocorrelation time. Here's the Eulerian autocorrelation time. If you're very short compared to the Lagrangian autocorrelation time, you're ballistic because you haven't even gone to your next vortex yet. You're just going around your first one. If you're very long, you're in the diffusive regime because the flow has changed out from underneath you. And you're on time scales longer than the Eulerian time. And what I want to do is plot these cross sections through this at this crossing point, which is like an inertial time scale, at very short times and at very long times. Okay? And just to continue this fit, you can see that at very short times you're slightly super random walk, in intermediate times, inertial range time scales, you're sub random walk, and on long time scales you go further. There's a higher probability of going further than a random walk would give you, and these are those cuts. Okay, so let's just stop here and look at what the data. This is the data from the point vortex simulation. At very short times, let's look always at the black curves. The fit is always in solid. The ratty thing is the real PDF. At very short times, you have a probability of going long distance that exceeds a random walk. At very short, at intermediate times, you can see there's a significant deficit in how far you go, what your probability distribution is for long distances. And at long times, when you really think you should be diffusive, you have this excess. You're not along a random walk. So if turbulence was strictly diffusive, all of these PDFs would lie. And by turbulence, I mean this flow analogy of a collection of point vortices. All these PDFs would lie along the Rayleigh distribution. And clearly there's...
This is just the number density, something like that.
This is the probability density of going a certain Eulerian distance in a certain amount of time. At three different times, very short times, intermediate times, and long times. Okay? Now, before I get too carried away, does this flow and have anything to do with a real turbulent flow? And let me just show you, we've done some preliminary work using one of Pablo, not this particular one, but putting Lagrangian tracers in one of Pablo Manini's homogeneous isotropic turbulence. You see the same transition from ballistic to diffusive for the expectation value of R. And if you look at the PDFs themselves, you can see that you do not get this excess at very short times. You do get this deficit at intermediate times, very significant. And in fact, in some simulations, you get this excess at long times. Okay, so there's at least some hint that some of this behavior is also seen in homogeneous isotropic turbulence. First point I want to make about interpreting this is, what can the spectra themselves capture? If you construct time series so that the autocorrelation and the cross-correlation between the velocity course components mimic the real data, you get essentially a random walk distribution with the same ballistic and diffusive regimes, and you do not capture at any times, this is the intermediate time, at any times these deviations from a random walk. And the reason for that is that the spectra don't capture the phases of the flow. Okay? So what we want to do is capture this phase information, in other words, this trapping events. And you can see that if you get stuck around a vortice, maybe that's an explanation for why you have a lower probability of going long distance, right? And so we want to capture that phase information in the statistical model itself, okay? And so we do that with a prescription that is strictly literal. We say, okay, what if we really have eddies? Those eddies are circular motions. And what we're going to do is construct a random walk out of chords of the eddy. So we want the Eulerian distance we go. So if we're spinning around this eddy, all right, and then we say, okay, delta t has passed, how far have we gone? Then the distance we've gone from the place we started is the Eulerian distance, is just the chord of the circle. It looks like this. And so we're going to construct a random walk, right, where you undertake eddy motion for some amount of time, which I'll describe in a minute. You sample a distribution of eddy sizes, and you move at a distribution of eddy speeds. And we're going to just go from one eddy to the next, and then every delta t, we're going to see how far we've gone in the Eulerian sense. Okay, so we're coding in circular eddy motion in the random walk itself. Okay? All right. So we do this.
Sorry,
Ah, so that's a great question. The question was the lifetime depend on the size? The remarkable thing, the most remarkable thing I find of this solution is that you can choose these distributions independently. Okay? So the amount of time you're trapped can be chosen out of a uniform distribution between zero. You can actually put a Kolmogorov time in here if you want. Okay? But for it doesn't make much difference. For simplicity, zero to the Eulerian integral time. So by that time, you're untrapped because the flow has changed out from underneath you. And that trapping time is uniformly chosen out of that time interval, and that's actually motivated by the trapping time distribution seen in the point vortex flow, okay? So in other words, if you had a turbulent flow, you would want to know what the trapping time distribution is. In this flow, it's uniform, or nearly so, okay? And that's not dependent on the eddy size. So you can go into a big eddy and get trapped long, or you can go into a big eddy and get trapped short, or you can go into a small eddy, vice versa, all combinations. And independently, we take the trapping radius, okay, to be Kolmogorovly distributed up to the integral length scale of the problem. And now this maximum trapping radius at the integral length scale has one caveat that I have to introduce in a minute, okay? But basically, Kolmogorov, in other words, the energy of the eddy tells you how likely you are to get trapped, okay? And that means that the radius of those eddies goes as r to the 4/3, okay? And then we take a velocity distribution of how fast we're circulating around the eddy to be either simply Maxwellian or Rayleigh in 2D or the observed one. And you can see that the observed velocity, Lagrangian velocity distribution, and look at the black one here, is non-Maxwellian, has this tail on it. So if we want this exactly, we would have to use this, we'd have to include this tail of high velocity on the Lagrangian distribution. And so we randomly sample these things, and construct a random walk so that the step size is given by this. So we have a variable step size that encodes moving in circular motions. And in fact, the reason homogeneous isotropic turbulence simulations likely don't show the short time excess. That was the only piece that was missing from the 3D, is because they don't have this tail on the Maxwellian velocity distribution, which is introduced because it's a point vortex flow and you can get really close to it and have really high velocities. Okay, so the 3D homogeneous isotropic turbulence would have a Maxwellian distribution like this and not show this tail. Okay, and so they don't, and that tail is what's going to contribute to the very short time excess. Now there's one caveat that I have to speak about, and then I'll talk about the results. And that is that the lowest wave number, largest scale flow in the domain is not included, it can't be included in this random walk. And the reason it can't be included in this random walk is because when the direction of circulation, the random walk knows nothing about the direction of circulation. So when you move from this eddy to this eddy, nothing has changed. And so we put in an Eulerian flow on which the random walk is superimposed. And so you need to know both this is the constructed at one instant at time. No, this is the average over all time of what that background looks like. But of course, those modal amplitudes change in time. And so you can either put this in as a steady flow, or you could imagine putting it in as a time-dependent flow in like a SGS type of simulation. But you need this Eulerian component. And then the remarkable thing is you can get really close. Okay, there's one caveat here, is that the width of these distributions from the random walk have been scaled. I think I know why I had to do that, and I think I can correct that, and that's because I double counted this flow in my velocity distribution, and I haven't checked that yet. But you get the shapes exactly right. This excess is in the ballistic regime. The reason it has an excess is because the PDF of velocities has an excess. So if it's basically VT in the ballistic regime, and so this shape is just reflected as reflecting the underlying Lagrangian velocity distribution. You can't see it here very well, I'm sorry, but if I just put in a Maxwellian distribution, I get the Maxwellian. It's in gray here. I can't see it, but it fits the Maxwellian distribution. And again, that piece is not seen in the 3D homogeneous isotropic turbulence because, in fact, the Lagrangian velocities are homogeneous and in homogeneous isotropic turbulence are Maxwellian. Here, you get the shape. Not only do you capture this tail, this reduction in distance travel, but you capture, this is a very difficult PDF to capture here. It's like flat in the middle, okay? And that shape results from this mean flow, and that tail results from the trapping at integral timescales. And then at very long timescales, if you hold this steady, you don't get this excess. But if there's a time-dependent mean flow, effectively what you're doing is you're sampling different Maxwellians of different width, because the mean flow is time-dependent and it increases the width of the Maxwellian of the random walk. And if you average Maxwellians of different width, you get exactly this. And so when you put in the time-dependent mean flow, you recover in the blue here the excess at very long times. All right. So what's been achieved? I think a simple scalar transport random based on a random walk with phase-preserving eddies determining the step sizes. Only one eddy component and a large-scale mean flow are needed. In other words, a random walk in eddies and a large-scale mean flow, and then ultimately you can simulate this based on measured statistics of the flow. In 3D, it's going to be a little harder. You don't have this. That's okay. That's a reflection of the PDF. You can see this is a little softer, and that's because you have motions along the filaments in addition to around them, and so you have to convolve but the along the filaments is in a random direction, so you have to convolve the random direction with the vertical direction. I think that'll be easily recoverable. And interestingly, this excess in 3D simulations, we conducted some where we enforced no large-scale flow. We did a forcing in which we had no large-scale flow, and this goes away. But if you do have a large-scale flow that's time-dependent, you see the same excess for likely the same reasons. I think I'll stop there. Basically, I'm saying there's some problems in which we need transport models statistically. I think those problems are not just because of resolution issues, but what's really important is the expectation value of the solution. Steve showed us yesterday some beautiful ways to get at the statistical solution rather than doing 1,000 simulations. This is another approach to that, and I think we've successfully combine these ingredients, and again, I can't emphasize too much, I might get too excited, but that we are using simple statistics of the flow to reproduce transport PDFs, right? By applying a consistent eddy description of the motions in physical space so that we capture the phase relationships. Okay. Thanks.
Questions? Maybe in the back there was the first one. I saw a hand up.
Just a very general question. I think most of the people in this room are interested in flows that are not homogeneous and not isotropic. Have you thought about extending this to, you know, some sort of anisotropic turbulence, and how difficult is that?
Yeah, I think anisotropy could be introduced by having your probability distribution reflecting direction, right? How you capture that is going to depend, again, is work, right? We have to figure out how to do that. But if you had a PDF that was theta dependent, angular, right, then you could capture a wall or some non-isotropic, or gravity, some non-isotropic by transport, by making your probability distribution function a function of direction as well. And I think we could do that. Harder is vectors, right?
I had a question, Deb. Is there a way of including some interaction between the agents that are being transported?
Yeah, I'll just repeat the question because your voice is. There including a way of interaction between the agents? And I think that's a really interesting point, both because these are massless Lagrangian tracers, but what we might want to know is like a real massive particle in an accretion disk or something, right? And so we would have to put some inertia in here and hoping to do that, and then going after like a nearest neighbor distribution so that you can get the probability of sticking, right? And use the similar kind of mechanisms to go after a nearest neighbor distribution.
Yeah, as a function of size.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, these things acting back. I mean, you think about magnetic fields in 2D, right? You could say something about suppression of turbulent diffusion by active scalars.
Yeah.
You could do.
Right.
All right, excellent. Maybe we thank our speaker again, and we leave.
So I do realize I'm standing between you and lunch, and I have 165 slides. So okay. So this is a topic on astrophysical vortices. I started working on this back in when I was a postdoc back in the late 90s, and with Richard Lovelace, John Finn, and Sterling Colgate. And then over the years, we've been applying it to planetary disks. And recently, this is from ELMA, sub-millimeter array. And we start, you know, the community starts seeing, so there is a there's a young star in this region that's not showing there. The disks seem to demonstrate many non-axis symmetric features. This is a big horseshoe. What they're seeing is dust emission that's being heated by the central star and radiated in sub-millimeter. And this is a small compact region that's highly concentrated in dust. This is a nonlinear simulation I did back in 2001. Okay, so this is a topic I'm trying to link up some of the understanding of the disk flow dynamics together with dust evolution and also the observations. So I realize I only have a short time, but I do want to tie with some of the lessons I've learned from the geophysics community. And Glenn, I guess, has given the introduction on Monday on the disk dynamics, where we have a star, neutron star, black hole, where gas plasma is circulating around the central region, centrifugal force is gravity and pressure gradient. So when I was a postdoc, went to Los Alamos, Sterling was my mentor. He said, Hui, can we work on disks? I said, sure. And he said, okay, my idea of in disks is putting the pedal wheels. I said, because disk is notoriously stable and highly sheared, but he said, Sterling by nature is an experimentalist. He said, well, if we put in the pedal wheels, then they become very efficient in transporting angular momentum. That was the issue we were wondering about. So finally, with the help of Lovelace, Dick Lovelace, we actually wrote a sequence of three papers. The pedal wheels in this case turns out to be vortices that's lying in the R5 plane. Okay. And so we all know that the disk is very stable because the Rayleigh criterion and specific angular momentum is increases as a function of radius. And back in the 80s, there was a famous set of papers by Papalois and Pringle pointed out that this is a radius, this is a central object, you have a torus of matter around it, and you have a so-called Papalois or Pringle instability. And John Hawley actually did some of the best 3D nonlinear simulation. He straightened it out, make a torus like that, and become non-axis symmetric, unstable. He called it planets even. Okay. And so what's happening is that when I worked with Sterling, what we did, we say, okay, since the smooth disk is so stable, there's no way we can get anything to go. We asked the question, what if we have a strong density gradient? No, we didn't explain why and how to produce such a density gradient. We kind of just said, if there's a density gradient, what happens? So this is a radius, and this is one case where we just had a sharp edge, and then low density and high density. And then another case, we say, oh, just put a bump. And what happens is that, you know, through the pressure gradients, the rotation profile deviates from pure Keplerian. So you start, so this is the epicyclic frequency, you start having features like that, which turns out, if you go look this book, many of you are experts in this, that there's a really inflection point theorem is that this kappa square is still positive, this is function radius, and so the Rayleigh is still stable, this is axisymmetric mode, but when you have inflection points, it's a necessary condition for non-axisymmetric modes, but not sufficient. It turns out, so this is the reason for Rossby. So I went to the literature. I remember we're having lunch, and I think Ed Spiegel was visiting us. I was asking him about all those questions. He said, oh, go read the book by Rick Salmon. I said, how do you spell salmon? The fish that you're eating. So there was a book, maybe mid-90s, I forgot. So
I bought that book and read it, and there's other papers. This one I went to ADS last night has more than 1,000 citations on this topic. So this is where I started learning all the Rossby waves, shear instability, inflection points from you guys, basically. And so we went through, linearized the hydro equation in 2D. Turns out if you have density gradient, pressure gradient, or entropy gradient, we call this modified potential vorticity, this is kappa square, this is surface density of the disk, this omega rotation profile, this is entropy profile. And you have this key function, what we call, and you derive the WKB linear dispersion relation. This is the Rossby wave, and this deformation distance dispersion relation. Really, what it turns out to be is that there is a co-rotation resonance, and there is a trapping region where the Rossby waves gets excited, the positive energy and the negative energy waves gets amplified through this co-rotation resonance that could be a singularity if you don't have a growth rate. And what's also interesting is that if you do the whole disk region, that those Rossby waves can tunnel through those outer limbular and inner limbular resonances become spiral density waves. So that turns out to be the key mechanism, and with the outflowing boundary wave function. And I worked out the potential. Indeed, you have a trapping region, and the eigenfunctions become wavy-like. And then I learned how to write hydro codes with Bert Windorf. Some of you next Windorf codes. And I was writing my code, and some guy told me, he said, why don't you go talk to Bert? I said, who's Bert? And so this is the famous Lax Windorf, who's also at the lab. So we wrote a disk code and then simulate this instability and become fully nonlinear and get vortices. So, but at that time, the whole community was swept away by John's work. Everything's MRI, so forget about hydro and vortices. Now, in the rest of the time, I'm going to talk a little bit about the application. Now, with ALMA observation, they're seeing many structures that's quasi, what I call a mesoscale. So there are a fraction of the radius. And this is not resolved, by the way. It can be much smaller. So I'm going to try to talk about three effects that Rossby wave instability can be excited by: disk planet interaction, also at edges of the dead zone, and the dust-gas coupling. So just very quickly, some of the background on astrophysics. This is a disk called HL Tau, nearby star-forming region. And this disk is believed to be young, but we see 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 or 5 rings, suggesting something's going on in disks, although it looks quasi-axisymmetric. This is an older disk, which is several million years old, where we see big horseshoe region where dust is concentrated in that region. Now, this is more than maybe 4,000 exoplanet, where those disks finally evolve and all the dust and gas are being evaporated away. You're left with exoplanets. This is orbital periods in days. This is planet radius. Jupiter is there, Earth is there. There's just huge number of exoplanets, so there's a high percentage of star-like stars having planets. So somehow from this young disk, dusty, gaseous disk, you form planets, and ultimately the gas gets dispersed, and you end up with systems like that. So two outstanding issues. There are many of them. I've just singled out two. One is still the accretion disk physics, where you have a young star that's radiating from infrared all the way to X-ray. You have a disk, and you ionize some parts of the disk through different processes. What's causing the mass to accrete? So is it MRI, magnetorotational instability, which we'll hear tomorrow? Is it gravitational instability? Are there other hydro processes? And there's also the possibility, Shining Bai proposed model of winds that could also transport angular momentum. So all of this affects disk evolution, angular momentum, transport physics, as well as planet formation issue. The other is we know such disks not only accrete, form the star, but also form planets do everything in 1 million years. It's actually pretty difficult. This is observation. This is what we imagine could be happening, that in some region, the micron-sized dust coagulate, become planetesimals, and ultimately going to form planet. Just to give you a scale, from micron dust, you go from a planetesimal, the mass grows by 10 to the 33. Okay, I don't think Los Alamos computers can do this yet. Okay, so it's a huge multi-scale problem. If this is inverse scale here, you have global disk, which we observe, and possibly vortex, which I call mesoscale. But at a tiny micron or meter or kilometer scale, you have all the dust growth, which is also exciting. For example, streaming instabilities, there are effects of magnetic fields. That's not considered in this talk. So for this talk, I'm only looking at this region. And perhaps tomorrow we're going to hear some talks along those lines. Okay. So I'm going to, there are many observations now. There's maybe a dozen sources showing clear features by ALMA. I'm going to roughly group them in two major categories. One is we call ringed disk. There are actually three sources now published or to be published. I'm actually a co-author on this one. And you can see the rings are quasi-axisymmetric. Okay. And I'm going to propose a scenario which is basically caused by planet disk interaction to produce features like that. And there's another type of sources where you clearly see asymmetries. I mean, it proposes probably caused by that zone. Our equations are much simpler than some of you guys wrote, and the equations I'm dealing with here is no magnetic fields, which is maybe a big problem, but it's, hydro is already difficult enough. So this is 3D and the usual Navier-Stokes equations, but this term includes both viscous forces and dust and gas drag, and you have another set of equations for dust, which is I'm not showing here. The typical setup, we do R-phi in 2D or R-phi theta in 3D. Our code is called LA Compass. We include dust, gas, and planets. Self-gravity of both dust and gas are included. It's a two-fluids approach. Through the couple through the drag force. You specify those parameters. This is the typical 3D resolution. You try different dust sizes. That gives you different Stokes number. The coupling effectiveness is different. Different sound speed. We use isothermal equation state. We do have vertical stratification, but it's isothermal. That's a limitation. And the disk viscosity profile can vary as a function of R and Z. And I forgot to put a Z there. Okay, so scenario number one is looking at excitation through planet disk interaction. So the idea is that you have a 2D or 3D disk, you put in the planet, just say you have a planet, and ask what's the consequence of disk planet interaction. So this is a 3D run, but I'm showing the mid-plane behavior. And you can see that the planet creates a gap. This is density, so the blue region is the gap. And you form an inner ring, an outer ring, and actually it's unstable. And this is in the RZ plane, and not to the same scale. Really, the disk is very, very thin. So in order to visualize it, I blow it up. So you can see the planet does create a gap in 3D, concentrate some gas. The edges actually become unstable. So what is the micro, some of the physics issues here? It turns out if you, in 2D, it's a simpler equation. If you want to understand the vorticity evolution, potential vorticity evolution, it turns out it's modified by viscosity in the flow, shocks, and sometimes depending on how you grow the planet mass, turn it on, we call it adiabatic forcing. And turns out the shocks has the major effect in determining the evolution of the disk potential vorticity profile, because this is, again, I went to the fluids literature. The vorticity jump through the shock has has a density modification factor, and the curvature of the Mach number along the curvature factor along the shock front. So I just took this formula, and it worked out beautifully. And in this case, this is radius. This is azimuth from 0 to 2 pi. The planet is placed here. You got a global spiral shock cutting through the radial direction of the disk. And this is the planet here. You plot Mach number away from the planet, actually has this inflection profile. Mach number increases and then decreases. And if you go back to this, and that means the vorticity generation in certain regions, this slope is positive. In certain regions, this slope is negative. And so that's how you create an inflection point in vorticity profile. So initially, this is vorticity profile, potential vorticity profile. This is initially a constant. Planet is there at a zero. And then in some regions, because that curvature is positive, you generate vorticity. In other regions, the curvature is negative, so you decrease in vorticity. So that's why you build, it's like a pump. You build a vorticity profile difference, and that become Rossby unstable. And that's how eventually it become like that. So we applied this to I think I'm running out of time. I'm going to speed up. How much time do I have? 7 minutes, OK. So I'm going to show some results where, based on that mechanism, this is radius, this is 0 to 2 pi, and the planet is placed at 1. It's going to produce a gap in this region, and the edge is going to become Rossby unstable. And this is the gas density, this is the dust density, this is the potential vorticity. So you can see very quickly the edge. So the planet is at 1 again. So this is the low, blue is low density. So the gas become Rossby unstable, produce a vortex. And all the dust radially drift in, gets sucked up by this vortex. It's every vortex in the disk, it's like a vacuum cleaner. All the dust go in there. There's no passing. And just try, and you concentrate all the dust concentration becomes so high, it actually feeds back to the gas motion. And we think there's heavy core instability gets excited inside the vortex, and it's going to destroy this vortex. This was published a couple years ago. So if you lay them out, indeed, you can see it. Almost this flywheel feature gets generated. And this is the earliest frame. The vertices merge, form and merge into a single vortex. And the feedback starts tearing them apart. What's interesting is that if you ask how much mass it can concentrate by this vortex before it gets destroyed, and turns out it's actually several Earth mass. This is as a function of time. This is planet mass. And it can go up to almost 10 Earth mass. So what we don't have in this type of calculation is can we grow the mass and become planetesimal and let it drop out of the equations? Because we still use the two fluids treatment. And you can trap this much mass, and that's very good for planetesimal formation. And this is then we take that kind of model, fold it through radiative transfer in order to compare to HL tau disks. This is observation, this is model, this is residual. It did a pretty good job. Now, for a second scenario, given the time, I'm going to go quickly. This is radius, and this is the disk viscosity. And earlier I mentioned because of the ionization level is so low that you could have what astrophysicists call dead zone, where the viscosity is quite low and then switches on because the ionization fraction goes up. So this kind of edges, which is not very well modeled, and we postulate if the profile is steep enough that you can excite instability. And this is sort of how we visualize in 3D, where there is central region. This is R, this is Z. In some central region, the viscosity is very low, and outside is high. So this is a case in 3D where what happens is you see the Rossby vortex gets excited at the disk bound, at edge of the dead zone, because you have mass accretion, try to pile this up because the viscosity is low, density increases, you have a condition for instability. As you continue to drive it, this instability saturates and then smooths things over, but your continuous driving destabilizes again, so you go through the cycle. There's a good agreement between 2D and 3D, and we actually analyzed the M equals 1, M equals 2 modes, and you can see the red line is 3D and blue is 2D, and they show this epicyclic behavior because the continuous feeding of the mass and the similar amplitude. So if you capture through the whole sequence of this evolution, you can see that this is the gas distribution, this is 0 to 2 pi, now it's normalized by pi. Sorry, we jumped through different normalizations. But you can see we do get a variety of behavior depending on at what stage of the disk evolution you capture it. And this is the dust evolution, that it can be either a single clump or many clump rings. And if the viscosity profile is too smooth, you actually just get a ring. So the consequence of it would be that depending on the resolution of the observation, that you can get a variety of behavior. Either you have a quasi ring like this, this is increasing spatial resolution of the detection, or the vortex survives and becomes narrower and narrower because that's where really the dust is concentrated. So just to summarize, the modern observations seem to indicate there's many ring structured and non-axis symmetric features, and both giant disk interaction, giant planet disk interaction, or variable disk viscosity effects can produce those features through exciting Rossby wave and vortex instability. But much more work is really needed to look at the microphysics, how to couple the mesoscale vortex dynamics and the small-scale dust growth, and so that you can form planets and let them leave the system. And also, many of the vortex wave interaction physics hasn't been carefully studied, because that's also affecting the vortex dynamics in the vertical scale lengths, and also how long they can survive and how effective they can trap the dust. Thank you.
I just wanted to comment that an early criticism of this stuff was that you needed a rather sharp transition in the disk. But in fact, Vladimir Lyra wrote a paper not so long ago where he actually had a fairly gradual transition in the ionization state. But because of the nonlinear turn on of the MRI, he still got a very sharp transition anyway, so that this could go.
Typical Reynolds number of these flows?
So for 2D, we can get very high Reynolds number. And for 3D, typically we have 500 times 100 times 700. So then its Reynolds number is not very high.
And what about the dust particles? Do they? What kind of Reynolds numbers do they have?
They
are they simply Stokes particles? I mean,
we don't see turbulent effects from that. No, so none of these codes would be able to do that. So that's how we're saying that we're looking at from large scale gradually go to smaller scale. And there are other works where they look at streaming instability, which is concentrating on very small scales, and then they can maybe look at a much higher resolution. Yeah, I'm relying on my friends because like I was mentioning, if you, we only have a certain amount of numerical resources, right? So So we were going after the global scale and also dust dynamics.
I just mean that if there's a dead zone,
And that where the mid-plane could be highly neutral. So a lot of mass and dust will be concentrating there. So a lot of this kind of process should be occurring. In fact, one indirect way of confirming or inferring that that zone is actually doing this kind of modeling, that if you have active zones throughout, it turns out you cannot fit some of the features. And so I mean, this gets into technical detail. For certain inclination of the disk, the dust layer has to be very narrow in order to show up as a gap. If it's too puffed up as the gas, then you don't get the clear gaps. So that's actually support. You have a highly concentrated narrow layers in the middle that's neutral.
Okay.